Let's thank these guys for being here. Let me start with you, Nafessa, ask you what you thought of the character when you saw her on the page, because she has a very interesting kind of agency about her own life.
Yeah, I actually auditioned for the role of Angel at first, and it was cool. It was a fun audition, and then he brought me back in about a month or so later, and it was for Toya, and I was like, yeah, I want to play her.
You already liked her on the page.
I loved her on the page, and we created her together. You know, I called and was like, I don't want her to have just regular hair. Like, let's give her braids. Let's do something different. Let's have long nails. Let's just, like, really go there and commit to who Toya really is, the Toya that we all know around our way, the Toya who knows.
Well, do we now? Tell me more about this Toya that we all know.
So Toya is just very brave and bold, and she's very empowering. She knows what she wants out of life, and although she's not in college like the other kids, she has a lot to offer. And just when you think you want to judge her, you have a lot to learn from her. So I think she's one of those where you just sit back and learn something, because she's got a lot to offer.
Yeah, and like she says, she learns from life. So I think that was most important to me, having the character. Like, you know, you have these guys in school, but sometimes you learn some stuff from people, regular people who's not been so educated or so whatever. And I think for me as a person, like I learned a lot of lessons just from regular people. Like, you might learn from anybody, you know, on the street or whatever. Everybody has something to teach you. So I think that was important, to have a character like, you know, a well-rounded character, and she represented that.
Talk about the way you draw the difference between the guys and the women in the film, because it's interesting. The women are all kind of individuals, whereas the guys are defined by being in a group.
Well, I know, because definitely it takes place in a fraternity. So, like, I tried to, like, within the context of the story and the time I had to tell the story, I tried to, particularly with the women, give them much depth as I could within the time period of the story. So I wanted to kind of put them individually, so they all have aspects of the men's life, particularly Zurich. I wanted them to all represent three different things. I wanted the sorority girl to represent was the future that he would possibly get into. Rashawn kind of represents the future and the past, because she's, if he goes to the other side, he would be with the sorority girl Angel, and also Toy represents more of, I would say, the more well-rounded person that helps him figure out who he is as a man and why he's doing what he's doing. So just having those characters, you know, in contrast with the guys, really was something I really dug into deep. But I think it worked out, right?
Yeah, I think so too. Because it's funny you say that, because I think that Toya kind of represents, you talk about these guys representing the future. She represents the present. She knows who she is. Yeah. She doesn't have any illusions about anything. She's Yeah, everybody's talking about dreams. She's just sort of living in the moment, isn't she?
Yeah, and although she's not in college, she knows exactly what she wants to do. And she's smart enough to know, I don't have to go to college. I have real life that I can put into my book. I have this moment sitting with you that I can. She just takes from real life experiences. And she doesn't apologize for who she is. That's what I loved about her. It was just
also,
like,
unlike the guy, she owns every single space she walks into,
yes,
doesn't she?
Yes, yes. Very confident. I took a lot from Toya. I learned a lot from Toya.
What was the first thing you guys shot with you? What was the first thing you did?
My first scene was definitely Whataburger. Yeah. The fast
one,
food,
the
window.
No, the window.
The window
so,
was my
so
very...
So first time we see you is the first time we shot.
Yeah, first time we saw.
Yeah, that
and,
was
and,
my very
and,
first
and,
scene.
And actually it was fun shooting with the girls, because like I've been shooting with the guys, and it was so refreshing to shoot with the girls. It was a whole different thing, but the day we shot with the girls was refreshing. It was different. We had a different totally vibe. So the day we shot the Whataburger was really fun, because I was happy to be away from like the heavy stuff.
The heavy moments. And I thought Toya brought some light to the film, and you know, some lighter moments that we needed. It was heavy moments within the film, obviously. And the chemistry with my best friend at the restaurant, and it was just like fun, and the chemistry was there. And you know, we hung out a lot with each other offset, obviously. So the camaraderie, you know, we sleepovers and we were praying together. And what you see on screen, we had that off screen as well. So that it was just one of those fun movies to film.
How much of it was improvised versus stuff on the page?
You let us go a little. He let us go. He was good. He, yeah.
I think I'm poor. When I was
At the cashier register,
yeah, I just kind of was like,
go. A lot of that was improv, and which I love to do. So the actress in the scene with me, Adrienne Ray, like we just hit it off. It was like, this is my best friend from around the way. Like, who are these girls stepping to us? And it was just like one of those automatic things. She's from Delaware, I'm from Philly, so right there, and we had a thing together. So it was fun.
Tell me about how you rehearse and how you cast, because for me, seeing those guys get their haircut is the most harrowing moment in the movie.
Well, that's a whole different thing with the haircut thing. So I got about a week of rehearsal because this is with the five main guys. I mean, I didn't have much rehearsal. I didn't have any rehearsal with the girls. But with the guys, I did. I had about a week rehearsal to definitely figure out so they can have that brotherhood and bond would appear on screen. I had to really have to capture that. So went around and we did like a table read and I really like dug into the characters and wanted to know what they thought about the characters, how they felt about each other and we at one point we got it up off his feet and I had the guys that we was in the room just going through the scene and really going through the depths of the character and how they thought about it and I know one of the more complicated scenes was I was concerned about like when Zuri comes and he said I come from Kings and Queens, you know, I was like. He has really delivered on this, so that was a really scene we really kind of took a while to work on because I was like, man, you gotta really feel this. It's like this important thing in the moment. It's like, you know, you're taking a stand on something. And in that particular scene, we rehearsed over and over and over again, and I actually shot a lot of. That was one of the scenes I got a lot of takes in because I wanted him to really people believe it would. But him to believe what he was saying, also our audience to believe what he was saying about us coming from Kings and Queens and by respecting each other and it's okay like to love your brother. So we rehearsed a lot or whatever, but I didn't have any rehearsal with the girls at all. We just ain't had the time, but I figured I cast it. You know, my thing was if I cast the right people, they would come in there and get it. And they know what the schedule, the tight budget we was on. And
what was the schedule? How many days did you guys shoot?
We shot this film in 18 days, and we had 30 locations. So like we was just kind of like flying through everything, it was rushed. But you know, that's an independent film. When you're making stuff like this, you don't get much time. You don't get much rehearsal. You don't get much of anything.
Okay, but now I'll go back to you cutting their hair. So
cutting their hair or whatever, because I always knew they...
Know from the big outset.
That was always in a script about how I wrote that or whatever, but it was a thing where, you know, some of the actors have other roles, they you know, so they was like, oh, we got to... I said, like, we cannot... That's always been in the script, you know, we not changing that. So, you know, I had, like, the agents and all that calling me. I was like, look... We cutting their hair, and it was like can we get an example? They wanted like examples of pictures, and I was like, and I was sending like pictures of like them with lower haircuts, and it was like, wait, can you keep it at one? And I was like, yeah, we'll keep it at one, you know, like, but so them getting the guys to cut the haircut was a pain, but you know when they saw the film put together, they saw why I had to be there, and it worked.
But also, it's important physically for the movie too, because we need to see that and what that does to them. Because again, for me, the big difference is the women have, from Alfre to you, the women have their own lives and the guys don't. And I wonder at what point you decided to make that the way that we see the gender roles played out. Was that always the way you were thinking?
That was always scripted that way. Because I definitely wanted to have definitely a stark separation between the characters. So they, because I felt like with a film like this, you know, it was room for everybody to kind of have the, in a sense, a moment to really reflect on the character and say who they are. Because it's a huge cast, you know. Like we took about 7 months to cast this film actually with Kim Coleman. Like she said, like literally took a lot. So like, so I knew I wanted to catch the right guy so they all would have to at least have the, in a sense a moment. For them to really be on screen and get noticed for what the characters stand for and what they were trying to say with their individual characters.
Who was the first role you cast?
I would say Trevor, the lead. I had known Trevor for some time. We had met maybe like about 5 years before this, and it took a while to get the film going. And I knew he was always in the film. But I didn't know where. I didn't know where at first. I was like, I didn't know where because he was younger. He had to be Trevor's maybe about 22 now, so he was like 5 years younger. I was like, I don't know if he was, he was old, you know, because he was, I think he maybe was 17 at the time, just turned 18. So I knew he was in the film, and then I saw American Crime, and it was like, you know, I took a look back and I was like, yeah, he's the one. And I think him, and I think Trevante was second. Trevante Rose, he was Moonlight, because I knew Trevante for some time too. We were friends. I met Trevante maybe about 3 years ago, and I was like, I knew he fit in here too, but I didn't know where. I wanted to make sure, you know, everybody fit properly in the roles that fit. You know, he came in and auditioned too, and Trevor auditioned too. So it was like, yeah, they all auditioned for different stuff, and I had to plug people in who fit right and who fit right for each role.
Let me ask you in the face too, because did you like the idea that this movie is about the women know who they are in the way that the men don't? I mean, because usually when you see these kind of frat movies, it's about women being victims, and that's not really the case here.
And I think that was another thing that made me really want to sign on, is that all of the women in the film, you know, Angel, she was really, really smart, and, you know, she was into her books, and then Imani's character, she was strong, and she, you know, you're going to respect me, and then Toya, you know, they all just, it was about self-identification, and I think this, he portrayed this with the women in this film, that they really knew who they were, you know, as where they were able to give advice to the men or somehow guide them, because they were, you know, some of them were lost and trying to figure it out.
It's almost like that kind of age-old thing, especially in college, that the women always seem more mature than the
guys. A little
bit.
Which is true or whatever, because, and, you know, and I kind of wanted the guys to, in a sense, lean on women, particularly like sisters or whatever. I think that we definitely, as men, we lean on our sisters. So I thought that, I wanted to show that on screen. And I think that was important.
I see you wearing your purple and gold, so we know where you come from, right?
Yes, sir.
Oh, sir. Okay, get down and give me 20. All right. But talk about the idea of doing a film about this kind of, about this life, about black frat life.
Well, initially, it wasn't, you know, when I had the idea came about, I wanted to tell a story about, like, definitely a coming of age story. And when I found out some years back, my inspiration was actually when I saw that Robbie Champion had died, the guy from FAMU. And I was like, as a filmmaker, I would definitely want to tell a world in the story. And I was like, I just put it in a fictionalized fraternity. So it gives some context to talk about this subject matter in a real way. And get people talking about it, which is already, people are already talking about the film and subject matter because of the haze and stuff, or whatever. And when I first wrote the first draft, I sent it to the Sundance Labs, and they had helped me develop it. And
did you do like a reading with people from the Sundance Labs?
Yeah, like Michelle Satter and Lise McKimmy helped me like develop it and really strengthen the ideas and the characters to make it like, you know, because ultimately, it's about it's a coming age story about being a. I feel like it's, for me, it's about being a black man in America. So that was the theme I was trying to get through. It was not necessarily about like we see the hazing happen, but that's not what it's about. It's about brotherhood. It's about loyalty. It's just friendship. A lot of deeper things. So it's like I wanted those things to come through and just developing that time. It took me some time to really get to that place where it's not just a film about somebody getting their butt whooped. Because that's not the message I was trying to say, and I'm not trying to say like anti-frat or anything. It's just like, hey, it just happens, and let's talk about it. And she would come off because it happens, and it happens. And it's kind of like it happens more than not just black fraternities, but bands or anything, even to cheerleading squads. I mean, it happens like to people. So I thought it would be a great world to explore and a great subculture.
It's also, you sing a coming of age story. It's a coming of age story for the men and the women. And it really just kind of goes to show, I love this idea of the metaphor of the frat versus slavery and where is the break. Was that always there for you?
Yes, that was always there. When I was writing the script or whatever, I thought that I would introduce Frederick Douglass because I thought that he was definitely a prominent figure in American history. I think everybody knows who he is.
Except for Donald Trump.
Yeah. well, that's what I was thinking at the time. So I thought that I thought that I would definitely call a school, Frederick Douglass University, and I thought that I would implement like his teachings because I'm a student of his work. So I pulled from the narrative of Frederick Douglass, and I thought that I would use his quotes to kind of link to the process these guys going through to slavery and how maybe that's been implemented and maybe passed down. And that's why when he goes to the dean, he says things have changed, it's different now, and it's, things have changed overall from generation to generation. So this tying of Frederick Douglass and the history, our history of slavery in this country, into the brutality and how we treat each other as black men was kind of, I thought about that in the emphasis of the script.
Was it always going to be a fictional university, or did you think about maybe one of the actual HBCUs?
No, I knew it was going to be fiction because of the subject matter. I knew, and I kind of gauged that early on when I was kind of trying to push the project around. It was like, because I went to HBCU, so it's like, I know they're very
protective. Where are you in school? What you got?
I went to Howard. So, like, I know people protective of their images and all that, and I get that, but, you know, this is, I'm a filmmaker, and it's a story, you know, and I don't want anybody to feel like it was a slight against the university or anybody. So I kind of got a little, I was worried about it, but we ended up shooting at Virginia State. So we did shoot at Virginia State. So Virginia State opened their campus up to us.
They saw the script and let you come in?
Yeah, there was, because they had, well, maybe about a few years ago, they had some, the river they showed in the film, some guys had drowned. So they opened the doors with everything. So we, like, the dean scene with Steve Harris and Trevor, we shot that in the president's office. They opened the campus up. We had everything. We had access to everything. We shot all over the campus, and they embraced the film because they know, like, they felt like this film, eventually seen this film, that it might could save somebody's life in the future. So that's how they looked at it. But they was happy to have us, and we was happy to be there because a lot of students, as you see in the background, performers, and a lot of the actors were able to come be in the film, be part of the experience, and see what it was like to make a film and be there on campus.
One of the things I guess I like about the movie too is the women also seem really modern as compared to the guys. You know, they could be like almost from any generation of black frat life.
Yeah. And I actually went to HBCU myself. I went to Delaware State University. And, you know, I have roommates going through this process. So it meant a lot to me as a black woman to tell this story because, like Gerard said, it could possibly save some lives. Yeah.
Were you worried about that though? I mean, because people HBCUs are really kind of, they're worried about their images, and you're worried about the idea of doing a film that is about that life, even though it's not strictly speaking about an actual school?
No, because like Gerard said, the main basis of the film is friendship and loyalty and a brotherhood or sisterhood, if you will. So I think that's more of the focus of the film, but like he said, Hazen is a part of it, but that's the underlying message for sure.
What was your frat life like?
It was for me. Yeah. It was wonderful. I mean, like, I mean, honestly, it was great. I mean, I think one of the best things that ever happened to me. So I don't have any, you know, any problems. For me, it was a great experience. I had a great time.
No, I mean, just wonder if you thought as you were going through it. I'm not asking you to judge it, but you thought there's a movie in this because at a certain point it's about sort of giving up your identity to before you get to the other side. So if there's a movie subject in the idea of black frat life, how far back does that go for you, the idea of making a movie about black frat life?
How far back the idea goes? Probably about 5-6 years ago. I mean, I didn't pledge frats with this in mind, you know. It was, it came, you know, my growth as a filmmaker and the stories I wanted to tell, things I wanted to get into, it came to me like later. I know after I had my because I actually started writing the script right after, because I was producing Fruitvale Station with Ryan, and so I started working on this like right after we wrapped like production. So I was kind of developing it and treatment and all that, but I didn't really get a draft to like five or six months later when that post had cleared on that film. So I would say maybe about from we shot last year, so. Probably about 4 years from that, back behind. That's when I had the idea of making a project, a film like this.
Well, talk about the Sundance screening, what that was like.
That was fun. Yeah. Sundances.
You go a little bit.
Every actor wants to go to Sundance, and you want to go with a film there. So this was really cool to be received well by Sundance.
Was your first Sundance?
It was my first Sundance experience, and it was with this amazing movie. And, you know, we were just about, most of us were there. And, you know, it was just a really good experience to watch it at Sundance together. And we had a really bomb after party. It was just fun. It was just really, really fun. And, you know, when you first, you know, take on the role, you don't know it's going to go to Sundance. And just, you know, after you hear about the film being finished, and that was my first time actually seeing it too, was at Sundance.
Oh, that was your first time seeing
the
movie?
Yeah, that was most of our first time seeing. I hadn't seen the movie, so it was just a... Yeah, no, he was tight. He was like, we came in, we did it. I saw a little when we had to come in and do our voiceover, but no, it was just an amazing experience to watch our film the first time there and not knowing walking into it that we'd be there.
Talk about the idea of we just submitting it and being accepted and then going.
Well, with Sundance, again, I don't know, because of course that's every filmmaker's dream. Go to Sundance, you know, like people be freaking out for Sundance. When I had a relationship with them, of course, for a while through Fruitvale Station also, and I won a student DJ award. And so they had reached out to me, actually right before we started shooting, and they had like some director's initiative they had created, and it was like, hey, would you want to go do this? We'll pay for it for you. And you know, so right before I started shooting in April, last year, I did like a little lab with them here in LA to actually, and it was right on point to help me prepare for shooting the film in May. Shot in May. After May, I came back to LA with all the pieces, and it was like, hey, we want to see a cut of a scene. And I was like, yeah, sure. So I sent them a cut of a scene, and they liked it, and they gave us some post money for some post money. And after that, we just had them looking at cuts. Like they had advisors, like professional editors, professional people that's in the industry that can give notes on a screen, on an actual cut. So we had them like real top-notch editors, real top-notch people in the industry looking at it and giving us notes, producers, to make the cut strong so we do submit. So we submitted in October. I didn't hear anything about to Sundance a week before Thanksgiving. And I didn't know because everybody was freaking out. Did you call? And I was like, no, I don't want to call me. Just
I kind of
have heard rumors. Yeah,
everybody kept calling, asking, like, because they call you, and they call you, and I was like, no, nobody called me. I was like, you know, nobody called me. Just y'all chill out or whatever, you know, because it was freaking me out a little bit. I was like, y'all chill out, you know, we get in, you know, I was like, either they feeling it or they not, you know, so I know people I went to film school with submit films all the time, and you just never know with that. It's like, you never know with that. So they, you know, I got the call. I was actually heading to ADR to drive, and they called me, and I was like, hey, Gerard, well, I'm one of the programmers. We really liked Burning Sands. We thought it was great. You know, we liked that, you know, they liked the themes that was in the film. And I was like, yeah, we would love to have it play a competition. And I was like, I just pulled over and I put a phone on mute and I started screaming. I was happy and definitely blessed to be there. And I was grateful that they did really want, had the film there. And we got there, it was a lot. Cause we had like six screenings. And it was different. Every audience was different, how they felt about it and the opinions about the film. And so I was just happy to be there and just go through that experience and really get people to see the film and watch it with an audience in Park City. I mean, so it was really definitely, I would say, a dream come true. And I was thankful for the whole Sundance Institute for like supporting the film and supporting me as a filmmaker. So it was everything worked out really good.
What was it like seeing Toya up there on the big screen?
It was pretty cool. Again, Sundance is the dream for every actor, every filmmaker, and just was really grateful to be able to be there. And yeah, it was cool to see Toya. It was one thing, you know, doing it on set, but seeing her on screen, it was just like, wow. And the moments that he captured and just his direction, you know, we trusted him. He's an actor's director, so.
Talk about being directed by him, because you said he gave you some room to improvise a little bit.
Yeah, right? He gave us room to improvise. He said, as long as, you know, you pretty much keep to the story, you know, show me who the character is, you know, like he allowed us to have input. You know, I called him with the hair and with the nails, and I just, every idea that we pretty much had, if it made sense, he was okay okay with it. So, and the scene with Trevor and I, we really took our time. Yeah. We took our time
with
that.
They really tried to rush us because, again, it was an 18-day shoot. And I was like,
this is a scene that cannot be rushed.
I was like, we just going to go
so
over.
Let's take our time. And we took our time and we played with it and we tried some things. And it really came out great. I was really, really excited about seeing that scene in particular.
Because I was wondering if you were a little worried about that scene.
I was. But I had to, what you guys saw on screen, I had to do that in my audition room. So, I mean,
that was your audition scene?
Yeah, that was my audition scene. So, I went on, it was kind of crazy. So,
wearing those shoes, because that would have put it over for me.
No, I had on heels.
and when she did audition for the scene, I know it was like she was the one, because it was the chemistry she had with the guys. Because, like, I had some guys kind of, in a sense, casted at that point. So, I was like, when she came in and did it with the group of guys, and with the, it really, I was like, she's the one. I mean, I can't be, and I think we almost lost her because it was like she might get another project or something. We wasn't sure, and I was like, please lock her in, Kim, because Kim Coleman was our casting director, and she was like, because some people we actually lost because the schedule, we kept being pushed back and dealing with like the.
How far back was the schedule push? What was your first start date? When did you find, how long a time period was that?
We were supposed to actually start like
January.
Yeah, but we didn't actually start till May.
Wow. Yeah. Wow, was it just waiting for money to come into place and that kind of?
And like, you know, all come together because originally we were supposed to shoot in Georgia, but we ended up shooting in Virginia because Virginia was better for production money-wise. And Georgia wasn't giving us no break with a small independent film like this. And then we shot non-union in terms of the, not SAG, but everybody else. We shot non-union, so there was producers want to, you know, sneak around unions and all that stuff, so we had to deal with like that because we couldn't afford a union because it would have ate up all the money needed to be on the screen and not like in you know people's
pockets.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask you about the name Zurich, because when I heard that I thought, wow, that's Zurich, Switzerland. Talk about where that name came from.
It was randomly. So to me, when I'm thinking about like. When I hear like a cool name or whatever, I have like a book. I keep like names that I like when I'm thinking about like stories in the future or characters. So I just kind of like, that was a name that I had like in my file names when I think of cool names or character, what I might want to put. So I knew the names from Switzerland and I was like, this could be a cool name. That's from a black dude or whatever, you know, that's what I was thinking. I was like, So I'm calling Missouri. So that was more thing. I just kind of a name I picked out of my name catalog of characters. Like I put him in the screenplay.
Talk to, because also the only parental figures we see are the professors and the dean of the school. There aren't any other adults for them to sort of really bounce things off of. Except for the doctor we see, a couple of people, a little bit, but there aren't really adults in the movie. Mm-hmm. Talk about that a little bit too, because that's an interesting thing to do.
Well, I wanted a very insular, isolated world. I didn't want to like go into the parents and the dad and the, you know, people. I just wanted, because really when you're in college, you really don't see those people like that. You really don't. I mean, like you might talk to your mom and your dad, whatever, but you, it's mostly your friends, and that's the world you live in, because I come from that world. So you're not really interacting with your parents unless they're in the same city as you. And if you're 3,000 miles away from college, you're not going to be seeing your parents like that, or any adults. Only adults you might run in contact with, people, your professors, the people in administration, they become like your, in a sense, your parents. So I use those as like, you know, in a sense, as a metaphor for the parents that wasn't, the real parents that wasn't there.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too, because these guys, again, most of the women really seem to need to parental figures, and they're all talking about family, and you can sort of feel the lack of family and that gap, that void that needs to be filled, can't you?
You do feel that, because I mean, I think for all these young men and women, when you get to college and environment, I mean, you do yearn for that, like family or like people, the group mentality, to be part of somebody, something bigger than you are. So I definitely wanted to play with that.
What, tell me about Toya, what you thought about. Is she from there? Does she grow up there? What's her story?
Yeah, she's one of those. She grew up in the neighborhood.
Local.
A local. Yeah, and grew up near the college, but didn't go. And, you know, obviously didn't have the privileges of some of the kids in college. You see, she's working at the fast food restaurant, but she's got a dream. And she know that she's bigger than Virginia or Atlanta, where the film is to take place. Yeah, so she's an around the way girl for sure, who's just so happens to be homies and, you know, friends with the college kids. And again, she has something to teach them, even though she's not in college herself.
I just wonder, as you were writing this, though, because there's so many people in it, and the keeping all those stories clear. I mean, how many drafts did you go through so that everything is, we know where we are all the time? Because there's a lot going on. You said 30 locations. There's a lot happening all the time. How long did it take you to get the script in this kind of shape where everything was clear in every scene?
About 10 drafts, to be honest. The characters, probably about a third or fourth draft, I had all the characters clear. Because the first draft was like just getting it out there. I think, you know, just kind of like throwing up everything and then like clean at that point, just figuring out what's needed and what's not needed. Because it had a lot more characters. Yeah. I had more big brothers. I had more characters. And I realized it couldn't be, it was too much. It was, people were being confused. And I was like, I'm not making a mini series, you know, like, so I had to kind of cut a lot of things down and make it clear. So it took a while, but again, with the Sundance Institute helping me develop, they would give me notes or whatever, like, hey, what do you think about this or whatever. And they helped me kind of figure out a lot of things, the holes it had in the script that I wasn't sure about, how to fix it or whatever, what was needed. Because some characters ended up being combined, you know, like I combined some of the guys because it was too many, you know, it was too many people to follow. And, you know, but I had to swing you from like Square. We know he's a Square. We know that's the choir boy. We know that it's a football player. So the mean guy, you know. So it was like I just kind of had to figure out those personalities and kind of make that appear on the screen, on the script, and also translate it to the screen. So it took a while to really crack that. It wasn't an overnight thing.
I wondered about that, because the other thing too, in addition to all the storylines being clear, is that we know who everybody is as soon as we see them, and that's a lot on you as a director to make that happen in that way.
And I was concerned about it because that wasn't clear at first, because people like I was confused of who was who, whatever, in terms of the screenplay. Yeah. But once we started, you know, once I shot it, whatever, I knew I would get it right, because I wanted, in terms of casting, I definitely wanted everybody to look different. And that was the thing too, I had a lot of talented actors come in that definitely deserved the right, but some people look too similar to each other, like, you know, and I wanted, actually the five main guys to look totally different from each other, and so that people can get a feel of who they are, but also by looking at them, but also by their personality. So, you know, some of that had to do with like casting the right people too, which was important.
It's also, I think, and you've been talking about this too, about giving the characters voice. I mean, everybody has a point of view that they have, and that must have been one of the things you liked about the script too, going from Angela to Toya. We knew who both these women were basically right away.
Very strong, and I love, again, like how he, you know, all three women were very strong and they knew who they were, and I was like, hell yeah, I want to give a voice to her and you know, like tell her story. So, yeah, that was cool.
I think Toya, this was fun. I mean, because I think she, for me, like, when I started watching the film, I was like, you know, Toya Teen became definitely my favorite because she lights up the screen when she comes in. Like, you know, you want to laugh.
You know she's right here, don't you? Yeah, you know she can hear you.
She lights up the screen, you know, when she comes. And to me, it feels really good when I see, you know, the Toya scene. When I was editing the film, I would just go look at her scenes and see how they really tracked overall. Because I feel like, people like her. People quote some of her lines, and I think that...
And she was just fun. I mean, the second scene was the party scene. It was just... Oh, yeah. I think that was my second scene at night, and it was really hard to, like... The guys kept making me laugh, and we just kept having fun. And who was Octavius and Duran, who plays Square. And they just had jokes, and it just made it very light and fun. You know, she had her moments of when, you know, it was time to be serious, and, you know, serious matters were going on. But she was just fun.
Talk, if you can, a little bit, too, about getting Steve and Alfie for the movie. That must have been a really big deal for you.
Oh, yeah. It was a huge deal to get Steve and Alfie. Kim Coleman actually recommended Steve. When I wrote the screenplay, I had in mind that I would want definitely somebody established for this dean and professor. I knew that when we were writing the screenplay. But I didn't know particularly who. I had ideas of people, and Kim Coleman brought up Steve Harris, and I was like, sure. I said, is he going to do it? You know, because, you know, you never know. They have a lot of things going on. And then Stephanie Elaine, she knew Alfre Woodard, And I said, what about, you like Elfrey? I said, yeah, I love Elfrey. I mean, like, what, can we get her too? You know, and she, they sent it out to him, and it was like, yeah, they want to do it. And it was like, I got a call, like, while I was in Virginia, because we didn't have those two casts. We didn't have those two roles cast when we were in Virginia. I didn't meet them while we were
filming. Because they weren't cast. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That was on definitely on pick up Stephanie Lane for getting Elle free because she was friends with her, and Kim Coleman for recommending Steve Harris. But I was happy to have those two legends to come and to get them in the singing together too. It was really made it cool. So I mean, those people I followed for years, and I was really grateful to have those real brilliant actors to come work on a small film like this.
Well, it's worth it. Let's thank these guys for being here at the Brilliant Film.
Thank you.